The Illuminati Formula to Create an Undetectable Total Mind Control Slave by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 11. Chapter 5b, The Skill of Lying, The Art of Deceit, Billy Graham. Continues. The Top Secret Amish Front, and Hutterites. It will probably assist the reader to know that both of the authors have first-hand experience with the following information about the Amish. Fritz was Amish for several years as an Amish church member in church districts in Kansas, Missouri, and Illinois. He has also visited numerous Amish settlements in the U.S. and Canada, and lived and worked with the horse and buggy Old Order Mennonites, not to be confused with the Old Order Amish Mennonites, in Ontario, Canada for half a year. He has a manuscript of a book that he wrote about the Old Order Amish Mennonites, and has gone so far as to inquire with publishers like National Geographic if they would like some of his material. He has also attended a variety of Mennonite churches, including Church of God in Christ, Mennonite, Holdman's, Charismatic Mennonite, Conserve Men, and Beachy Amish churches across the U.S. He also knows firsthand that Illuminati slaves, some of who are programmers, have been infiltrated by the Illuminati into Mennonite churches. Perhaps what may come across as the strangest religious front, and it is certainly one of the biggest secrets of the intelligence agencies, is their use of the Old Order Amish Mennonites as a front. The Amish are the most pacifistic people, so the Illuminati and intelligence agencies have placed some of their best programmed assassins behind the front of being Amish. The front is real. They are Amish, well, many of them. Some were Illuminati children switched at birth to give the programmers better bloodlines to work from. Some Amish women in cult families have let the Illuminati impregnate them with stronger bloodlines. Many Nazi bloodlines were hidden after WW2 under the Mennonite and Amish cover. The Mennonites and some of the more progressive Amish adopt many children. The Amish in Missouri, Jamestown, Kansas, south of Hutchinson, and Oklahoma, Guthrie, OK, Kentucky, Ohio, Holmesco, O, and Pennsylvania, Lancaster, PA, have been involved in selling their children to the Illuminati. When the Illuminati would buy a child, they would send in one of their own midwives to help with the birth and retrieve the child. Generally, the Amish would sell their children when they realized they were going to have twins. One would be given to the cult, and one would be kept by the Amish parents. Because these children are born outside of the system, and have no birth certificates, they made excellent children to use in porn. They also can be used as expendable children to use in porn. They were often blonde-haired and blue-eyed. The Amish women were not allowed to use birth control, it was forbidden by the church, and they were not allowed to have an abortion, and it was their duty to have sex with their husbands. It is possible that some parents sold their children just to get out of the responsibility of having another child. The Amish farms in Kansas and Oklahoma and in the border states like Missouri and Kentucky are mechanized with tractors, and they don't need the large families that the Amish in other places need. Due to the strong legalism that pervades their church, some have tried to get around the tight spot that the rules place them in by selling a few unnoticed children. However, there is an active witchcraft practicing occult group within the Amish which is like a box within a box within a box. It is very secret. There are many ways of describing what is going on with the Amish. Let's describe quickly in half a page, it could be a book in itself, what a deep look at the spiritual dynamics of what is going on with their communities. The rise of Satanism within their ranks is simply a natural outgrowth of the spiritual dynamics. There were two trees in the Garden of Eden, one was the tree of life and one was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The first meant being transformed by the Creator who made them into the image of the Spirit of God and receiving spiritual life, but the other tree was performance. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil, religion, includes both law, good, and license, evil. As soon as a group gets legalistic, they fall from grace. They then separate themselves by their performance and say in effect, look at what we're doing, which is a form of pride. God resists the proud, so they through a number of spiritual dynamics lose fellowship with God. This means they must cling to their legalistic traditions even more, because a live relationship with God is gone. Bible studies are forbidden by most Amish church denominationalists, and they don't get new revelation from God, they still are working off of the revelations of the 1600s, when they were traumatized and quit growing. When they split from the rest of the Mennonites, they were like a child altar split which never grows up. When a group gets legalism, they also get license, because the two grow from the same tree. Every Amish community has two large groups, the legalistic ones and the license ones. The young people are even split this way. In Lancaster County, the Groffies is the nickname of the large license group of young people who fornicate and drink. There is a smaller group of legalistic conservative young people too, who are at the other end of the spectrum. There is one group, gang might be a more appropriate name, called Jamborees, who are an unruly and destructive collection of angry wild young people. The bishops in Lancaster Co. meet twice yearly to keep this large settlement of opposites together. A lot of compromise and looking the other way is done for the sake of peace. Peace at any price is the name of the game. Even before a prayer is said in church, the minister calls out, "When Mayor Enoch sin, well a Mayor bet." This translates, "If we are in one accord, then let us pray." Because peace is so important, they are out of balance in getting it. They place peace far above truth. In order to have the appearance that everything is well, secrecy pervades everything like the air one breathes. Because their whole culture is secret, children raised in it aren't aware of how strong it is simply a way of life, like it is for the Illuminati. Legalism values conformity. Conformity prefers robotic obedience over understanding. In fact, one bishop told Fritz, co-author of this book, "We don't want our young folks to understand why they do what they do, we only want obedience. Understanding is dangerous." Does the reader begin to see how the Amish make both the perfect setting for monarch mind control, and the perfect cover? The Amish are a very secret group. During their early history, they suffered severe persecution. Their culture teaches them to suffer in silence, which today helps their satanic abusers infiltrate their culture. In the past in Europe, when the Catholic or Protestant Church caught them, they were tortured to death. They were hunted as animals and treated worse than animals when caught. This was the trauma that Satan did to them, and the lie that was then handed them was that if they would cloister themselves secretly in the New World away from everyone else, they would be safe. The Amish have shut out from outsiders the true flavor of their culture and beliefs. They are silent about their problems. They tell themselves that outsiders couldn't possibly be interested in their affairs. The Amish themselves are very divided from each other. The divisions between Amish groups is called Zwietracht. Zwietracht can cover anything from a mild aloofness to a full-fledged shunning, called the Meidung. The Amish aren't in general qualified to tell outsiders much in detail about their own heritage, or religion, because they are so isolated from the other Amish settlements and have been raised in such an anti-intellectual culture. Most Amish are content to know that the way they do things was always done this way, and that their elders and forefathers were gifted men who examined things very closely. Their social norms are not intellectually questioned by most Amish, but then American society has been very isolationist in the world, and few Americans question their society and norms. Americans even rebel in the prescribed fashion, whatever the elite tell society is the in cool hot stylish way to do things. The Amish are similar to the Mideast culture in that they have a very indirect approach to saying things. They do not consider it proper to speak with a negative connotation about anybody. They also instinctively give pat answers to outsiders to blunt questions. These pat answers border on being rigid, prejudiced, and simple. They serve the purpose to deter curiosity. The early Amish leaders were ex-Catholic priests, but most of the people were peasants who had little formal schooling, had little Bible knowledge, and came from southern Germany and the Rhineland, where witchcraft was practiced by the common people. The spirit of witchcraft never left the Amish. It has always been with them. The folk witchcraft is called Brauch, and the craft is kept secret by old men who pass the incantations down in secret. When the Amish moved to Pennsylvania, they moved in next door to Rosicrucians. When the Rosicrucian settlements fell apart, they joined the Mennonites, thus bringing their hermetic magic along with them. Somewhere within the Amish were some families that were undercover for the Jesuits, and were sent in as spies long ago because they were corrupt. These families have been generational Satanists, which practice pedophilia and other crimes in the safety of their isolation. They were placed within the Amish to help the Catholic Church destroy the Amish. In Europe, that happened under Hitler, when all the Old Order Amish were arrested in 1938 and wiped out of Germany. Prior to WW2, the Nazis, part of the Illuminati, sent over a number of programmed multiples which set up an unnamed cult in upstate New York. This cult was to help Hitler take power in the US when the Nazis won the war. They did not win the war, but 60 years later this satanic cult still operates. Now second and third generation programmed multiples are now part of this cult. Somehow this Illuminati mission coordinates with the Illuminati project to get Hitler's bloodline hidden among the Amish, although the authors are aware of Hitler's descendants being in Oregon, and Washington as well as Pennsylvania. One of them in Portland, Oregon works for the federal government. Lancaster County is sometimes referred to as the Mother Church. This was one of the original counties which the Amish settled in when they first came over to the New World. William Penn invited Rosicrucians, Amish, and other dissident religious groups to Pennsylvania. The Satanic Covens in Lancaster County, PA consist of members from Amish, Mennonite and Brethren churches. They are not simply all Amish. Lancaster County's Amish Will Fellowship will all the approximately 200 other settlements of Amish around the country. What is a peculiar phenomena, is that many churches that do not fellowship with one another, will still maintain communion with Lancaster out of respect for place in Amish history. However, Lancaster County has some of the most immoral reprobate Amish that there could be. All this is hidden very well from the thousands of tourists, due to the secrecy of the Amish. The Amish do not often pay taxes, do not pay social security because they are exempt from the social security program, and send many of their children to Amish schools. They are truly a separate society which maintains rigid secrecy. If you were the New World Order or the Illuminati, where would you want to hide your assassins? The safest place is inside of the most pacifist group in the world, the Amish. Monarch mind-controlled slaves are being created out of Amish children. During WW2, Amish conscientious objectors were forced by the government to do alternate public service in lieu of military service. This was known as civilian public service. Amish and Mennonite conscientious objectors were placed into mental hospitals to help. They served at Allentown State Hosp, Allentown PA, Cantonsville State Hosp, Cantonsville, MD, Cleveland State Hosp, Cleveland OH, Delaware State Hosp, Parnhurst, DL, Denver State Hosp, Denver Co., Greystone Park State Hosp, Greystone Park, New Jersey, Harrisburg State Hosp, Harrisburg, PA, Hudson River State Hosp, Poughkeepsie, New York, Kalamazoo State Hosp, Kalamazoo, MI, Lima State Hosp, Lima OH, Livermore State VA Hosp, Livermore CA, Macedonia State Hosp, Macedonia OH, Marlboro State Hosp, Marlboro, New Jersey, MT, Pleasant State Hosp, MT, Pleasant, 10, Norristown State Hosp, Norristown PA, Provo State Hosp, Provo Utah, Rhode Island State Hosp, Howard Rhode Island, Roseburg VA State Hosp, Roseburg OR, Stanton State Hosp, Stanton Virginia, Tiffin State Hosp, Tiffin OH, Wernersville State Hosp, Wernersville PA, Ypsilanti State Hosp, Ypsilanti MI. The author, Fritz, believes that the complete story of how the Illuminati got a secret foothold into the Amish community lies in what happened in mental hospitals to the anxious to please, compliant, innocent Amish boys, who were assigned to these mental hospitals. Many people do not realize that during WW2, several Mennonite and Hutterite conscientious objectors were tortured to death by our government. Not a pretty picture when you find out how sadistic our government was, willing to be toward its own citizens. Not only did the Amish boys go to lots of mental hospitals during WW2, but all of the religious groups that participated in the conscientious objector service, called civilian public service, contributed boys to the Office of Scientific Research and Development, part of the Army, which was still using these boys for experiments until December 31, 1946. What kinds of experiments were the Amish boys, who were offered up as guinea pigs, subjected to by the OSRD? We now know that some of these experiments were very dangerous to their human guinea pigs. 1-0 classification was the Selective Service Board's conscientious objector classification. During the Vietnam War, Amish young men went into IW service, conscientious objector service, at mental and regular hospitals. Their IW service was for 2 years. Some of these young men were programmed at these hospitals. One Amish boy, after he got home from IW service, committed suicide. The secret satanic families within various Amish settlements also offered up their children. This started a large-scale super-secret operation by the CIA and intelligence agencies to set up Delta teams within the Amish. Who would ever suspect an Amishman? They have been expendable assassins for the CIA for years. These young men are strong farm boys. They have no connection between themselves and the outside world where they secretly carry out their missions, and if they die, there is no birth record, and perhaps a dozen other siblings for their family to continue on with. During the Vietnam War, the military's selective service did things differently than in WW.2. Any hospital or mental hospital which applied for approval could get IW, conscientious objector, boys. The Amish put together a steering committee to work with the government and the IW service. In the IW steering committee meetings, and the author Fritz attended one, it was stated by committee members the boys do not come back the same from the hospitals and that the IW service in the mental hospitals was proving unsatisfactory and harmful. Some of the mental hospitals which received Amish boys include Columbia, Missouri State Mental Hospital and Hospital Complex, Colorado Psychopathic Hospital in Denver, all of the hospitals that got WW3WS, as listed above, Central State Hospital, Indianapolis, Indiana, New Jersey State Hospital, Greystone Park, New Jersey, Philadelphia State Hospital, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, plus numerous others. At any one time, there were hundreds of Amish boys in IW service. It is suspected that many of these hospitals were involved in mind control, and it is known that the Columbia, Missouri Complex of Hospitals and Mid-Missouri State Mental Hospital, 803 Stadium Drive, Columbia, Missouri, and the Veterans Hospital across the street were involved in mind control for the CIA. A mental hospital had to apply to the Selective Service Board for approval to get IW workers. Then their personnel departments would hire the IW boys for positions such as nursing attendants. One state mental hospital administrator told Fritz that the whole IW thing was pretty confidential. The Amish steering committee worked with the Mennonite Central Committee, MCC, which in turn worked for some quasi-religious group which is privately funded called the National Service Board of Religious Objectors, NSBRO, still active in Washington, D.C. The Amish were slow to act, but by the end of the Vietnam War, they had managed to get some of their farms approved for IW service, and in 1971, the steering committee was able to announce that 70 Amish IW boys were working on Amish farms in 8 states, rather than in hospitals. However, this late change was too late to protect their settlements from infiltration from sophisticated Illuminati mind control. How it is done? A programmed Amish boy will likely be contacted by what is called a cutout. This is the secret contact person who maintains contact between the handler and the Amish Delta. Cutouts can either be given several slaves, a block cutout, or in other cases only know the upline handler and downline person, a chain cutout. If further secrecy is needed by the handler, he can use sterile telephones which the Illuminati and CIA have which cannot be traced, even by the telephone companies. When an Amish boy is activated and sent out on an assassination mission for the Illuminati and intelligence agencies, he is a professional at what he has been trained and programmed to do. Amish boys, programmed to be assassins, are used in what their handlers call wet ops. This intelligence lingo means that human blood will run. Wet ops, also called black ops, are debriefed by a briefing team. The Amish multiple will have to give a detailed account of the finished operation, once under hypnosis, once with a polygraph, and once under the drug scopolamine, a truth serum. And when the debriefing team, which includes a mind control programmer, is satisfied that all of the inconsistencies between the different accounts have been ironed out, then the programmer will block out all memory and guilt of the operation. The handler may write a blind memorandum which has no file number or letterhead or name. Then Amish boy's assassination altars will be praised for having done a great service to humanity and to his country. The Amish boy can now be sent home to milk cows and work on his labor-intensive tobacco farm without any nagging guilt or horrible memories surfacing to trouble him, at least in theory. Trained assassins do have memory flashes, as all monarch slaves have, but they are only bits and pieces. People also do not realize that the Amish live in many more states than Pennsylvania. They move all over the United States. If an Amishman was traveling on a CIA mission, there are numerous of excuses that could be made for why he could be on the move. There are far more Amish young people away from the Amish settlements than people realize because they dress like the world. Many young people leave with the knowledge that they can go back years later and be accepted back into their community. What are some of the mitigating factors in all of this? The Amish do their own butchering. They are down-to-earth people who are not afraid of blood. Essentially, all Amish children grow up helping with butchering, and seeing life and death played out every day on their farms. The Amish do not embalm their dead, and have their own cemeteries. The satanic cult within the Amish can reopen the graves and carry out satanic ceremonies afterward. Their cemeteries are small, almost hidden sites with markers hidden in grass. Some of these graveyards blend in with their rural settings. Elmo, Joseph, and Victor Stahl are some prominent Amishmen. Joseph and Elmo have traveled a great deal, especially to Central America. Joseph wrote a book on child training which teaches parents how to break a child's will. This author is supportive of discipline and respect. The book is pointed out, only because it is a paper trail to show that the Amish discipline and the Illuminati's discipline at times can be similar. The only person who might see an Amish boy being disciplined, since they are a rural people, would be the immediate family or an occasional Amish guest. An Amishman seeing a father carrying out the monarch steps to build dissociation would likely not see anything wrong. If the guest did see something wrong, i.e. too strict or mean, the objections would be kept very low-key. For sure, no non-Amish would ever hear about it. The Illuminati families like the Dukes and Reynolds control tobacco production and cigarette manufacturing. In order to keep their lifestyle in Pennsylvania, the Amish have had to grow tobacco for the Illuminati-controlled companies. This author can only speculate what economic leverage that has given the Illuminati over the Pennsylvania Amish. Hiding a major programming center. The blueprints of the Portland Mormon Temple at Lake Oswego, or which sets over a secret underground programming site, were changed overnight after they were looked at. The original blueprints showed that Lake Oswego had allowed a building code to broken. The blueprint was changed, showing that Lake Oswego city employees were working along with the Mormon Church and the CIA to keep everything running smooth with their high-tech secret underground programming center, which has the front of being sacred temple grounds. Three separate monarch slaves independently described this underground installation, and there are other evidences of it too. In order to gain access to the underground programming tunnels, a person has to have to place their palm on the wall, where a disguised instrument identifies a person's hand. The entrances are disguised using the most sophisticated techniques. One is from the temple laundry building south of the temple, and another is from the hotel south of the temple. This hotel has a strange hard-to-find entrance to its parking lot, almost as if they haven't wanted uninvited guests. Tunnels are widely used at the other various programming sites. External and internal deceptions. There are some stock tools of deception that are used both externally on the world and internally on the slave when their system is programmed and structured. Later in the book we will cover the structuring. Since this chapter covers deceptions, we will discuss them here, but the reader needs to bear in mind, they will be employed in the structuring and programming phases of the slave's life. They are deflection, blinds, slides, Hegelian dialectics, and deniability. A deflection is taking something good and deflecting its purpose. This is a stock tool. For instance, loyalty and obedience can be good virtuous things if given to the correct authority. But deflected to the false sadistic authority, they are disastrous. They use deflection to redirect the power of truth which is opposed to them. Healthy foods, benevolence, ecology, love, acceptance, etc., are all part of the Creator's Christian walk. These truths and other are deflected from their original purpose of glorifying the Creator to glorifying their own programs. Rather than publicly opposing Christianity, they rename their own movements Christian, and then proceed to do very little for Christ, and everything for Lucifer. They are even deflecting worship of Jesus Christ onto worship of a demon named Jesus. Be the next externally and internally used stock tool is called blinds. These are deliberate deceptions placed within their own writings to confuse the uninitiated. HPB gives a good description of the use of these, so do Masonic writers like Albert Pike. HPB writing describes the use of blinds in The Secret Doctrine, Volume 5 Udyar Edition, page 435. Blinds are used in CIA documents. They are incorporated into the scripts that the altars receive. For instance, the In Fetro Moonchild ceremonies are not revealed to the non-hierarchy altars, but they are told that the moon children have to do with the cage tortures. See slides are truth that has been warped just slightly to take an investigative person into a dead end. An example of a slide is that the New World Order is satanic, but that only Nazis and stupid people think that Jews are involved. This is a slide, because then the Rothschilds who hide behind their Jewishness, cannot be mentioned as suspects without people yelling anti-Semitism. In reality, exposing these abusers has nothing to do with anti-Semitism, it's simply that all abusers, no matter what good front they have, need to be correctly identified as dangerous. Another example, an altar who pretends to be helpful is placed in the system who says that the door to get to a castle internally is the fifth door on the right in such and such hall. The answer is correct, but the door must be opened using the left side, rather than the right side where the doorknob is located. Because the answer doesn't pan out, then the idea that the door is the correct door is discarded, and the altar's knowledge is suspect. Lots of psychiatrists are writing papers about MPD with slides. They give some truth, and then they give people a path to go down that will dead end them from ever finding the truth. D. They use Hegelian dialectics. This dialectic process doesn't happen on its own, so it often has to be forced into happening. The idea is that each idea, ism, called a thesis, like say capitalism, naturally by definition has an opposite, an antithesis. In capitalism the antithesis is communism. The conflict between the two produces a synthesis. By controlling both ends of the conflict, one controls the end product, the synthesis. More than not, the one world power can be seen working behind both sides of many conflicts. Indeed, the secret societies have been historically shown to be behind all the revolutions and wars in modern Europe since the American Revolution. In religious conflict, both sides are often being manipulated. Some of the various groups openly admit their strategy is designed to create a synthesis. You will find Hegelian dialectics has been introduced into the U.S. educational system by the Skull and Bones Order, an Illuminati group. It was adopted in Russia by the Slavophiles in the 19th century. Communism, Nazism, Fabians, most New Age groups, liberation theology, and other parts of the power use Hegelian dialectics. Hegel in turn based his system on the ancient Greek atomists, especially Democritus. Hegelian dialectics is built into the conflicting scripts that altars are given. Slaves who are twinned to another slave will find Hegelian dialectics employed in their twinning programming. The Hegelian dialectics can be worked in with the double binds that the programmers love to use. Esoteric language. F. Indirect interference with truthful information getting out. This is done by stealing the impact of the truth, by printing a parallel story with disinformation at the same time, or leaking an opposite story with disinformation at the same approximate time. Disinformation leaks can be done through the mass media, or an individual alter. G. Deniability. When orders are given and language is used, it is on purpose vague so that the guilty can deny their guilt. At this point, it might be appropriate to cover some standard CIA tactics. They use some monarch slaves as live letter drops. An LLD is a person who will remail spy letters. They will use dead drop boxes, which are simply places that an item or message is concealed to be retrieved by some other criminal in the network. They may give the slave a gift which then has to be passed on. They may protect a written message by writing it on edible paper. Safe houses are used, indicated by things such as two lion statues along with pre-arranged OK signals, such as the position of a flower pot. Internal deceptions. When building an internal world, the programmers use every trick in the book to hide things. First, the abuse has to be hidden in silence, and then the MPD has to be hidden. Next, the real core needs to be hidden. Then, the purpose of a monarch slave needs to be hidden. All the time that this is going on, the programmers must constantly work at keeping the programmers' identities hidden, and their programming sites hidden. Programmers usually have cover names when programming, and then hypnotically have the victim see them as something else. For instance, Dr. Green had victim see him as a cricket. He even used a cricket noise maker that clicked while programming. In recent times, the programmers and handlers are programming their slaves to believe that they are aliens. The slave will generally be lied to that they have a twin somewhere. Internally, the programmer will begin making the system with the core-related alters and then the front alters. The front alters will be rearranged in a fashion that the structure of the system is confused. The front alters will be given heavy programming, to convince them that nothing ever happened to them, they had a wonderful life. They will be given fictitious stories about the programming, so that almost every item in a system has a cover story to mislead an alter about what is going on. Many things are placed in boxes. Clowns programmed to cut, are jack-in-box clowns that pop up when an alter even thinks unapproved thoughts. Some of the important things in a system may be hidden out front. An alter on the front may think it is stupid, and yet they have access to internal maps of the entire system, which they can remember only on code. If a person, such as a therapist or nosy alter, goes to look deep in the system for the material, he might be frustrated. Under a fanatically unsexual, asexual, alter, will be a sexual alter. Under a stupid alter, may be an alter gifted in a language or art. Alters are very often hidden behind opposite types of alters. Important things in the system, and many unimportant things, are all well guarded. Sometimes particular alters have to serve as the guards. Some of these guards are called gatekeepers. Gatekeeper alters will appear near the surface of a system, and then again deep in the system about level 10 and 12. Gatekeeper alters are alters that the programmer must go through to get to deeper levels. The gatekeeper alters are very heavily programmed to keep them in place. They will receive intensive lies. Some of the access triggers which must accompany the verbal codes are kept secret, by virtue of the fact that no person in their right mind would use them, such as needles, electroshocks, or slaps to certain parts of the body to trigger deep alters to take the body. Items in a system will be disguised, such as the clockmaker alter, and demons will make clocks to appear in the system like anything they want. The only way these can be adequately identified is that these clocks are always disguised as gold items. As the programmers work, they like to find word games, plays on words and double binds. They will also put in scrambling programs, deaf alters and foreign language codes to help protect their secrets. The alters who look the least to have programming may have the most. Duplicate alters of most alters are created, so that even the alters themselves don't know if it is themselves or another alter. These duplicates are called mirrored images and looking glass people, LGPs. Some of the mirrored images may turn out to be demonic entities that have been placed using high-level demonology. Suicide alters, who are trained to have a big smile and be clowns, mask their intention to kill the body when they take the body of a slave. A popular method for hiding things within the occult world has been boxes within boxes. A Masonic organization will have a rite, within a secret rite, with a secret group, with an insider clique. Common everyday items that surround the slave will be given special meanings. The songs the slave hears on the radio will, for instance, have code words. The programmers, due to the corruption of the music industry, knows what hit songs are coming out, and they will haul their slaves in and program them according to the lyrics of the soon-to-be hits. The lyrics will be written so that programmed meanings can be attached to certain words and lines. Something as innocent as watching TV, listening to the TV or to a sermon may actually be programming a special message into the victim. Hand signals will even be done over the news or other shows. For instance, Bill Clinton at his inauguration made a satanic signal during the inauguration ceremony. This sign of Satan is a standard hypnotic induction hand signal for slaves. Clinton waves the sign of Satan with his left hand at his inauguration. This is a hypnotic induction signal for slaves. Although some might interpret this as "I love you," which is handed by the right hand of a deaf person, this left-handed signal will induct slaves no matter what some people think the meaning is. No wise person would knowingly choose to fight their opponent blind and deaf, yet that seems to be the choice which many nominal Christians are choosing. They would like to live in denial and to characterize this book as doomsday or stuff and then dismiss and ignore this material. They want to eat, drink and be happy. If people think that by putting their heads in the sand they can escape the future, or even the present difficulties, they may be in for a rude surprise. The use of esoteric language. One method of deception is the use of esoteric language. Esoteric terms are understood by those deep in the occult, but are misunderstood by the common people. The best example is the term Saturn. Saturn. The word Saturn consistently turns up as an important word for the Illuminati and upper levels of the occult. Because Saturn is such an important concept, it should be covered in this part of the book. Therapists may encounter something to do with Saturn in a programmed multiple. Before Fritz began researching the elite of the occult world, Saturn was merely meant an enormous planet 95 times the size of the Earth's mass, the sixth of the solar system in an orbit of 29.5 years around the Sun. This means that the co-authors of this book are less than 3 Saturnian years old. Fritz was also aware that Saturn was the father of all gods in the mythology of the ancient world. David M. Talbot in his book The Saturn Myth documents how all over the world Saturn has been worshipped even more than the sun god. Saturn has been the secret god of the occult world. When we read in Deuteronomy 18:9-10, "When thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do after the abominations of those nations. There shall not be found among you any one that maketh his son or daughter to pass through the fire, or that useth divination, or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch." All of these practices are abominations done by Satanists today and are becoming commoner among Americans. Note that the first item mentioned by Moses in this passage was passing, putting, children into the fire, of Moloch. A commentary, Kiel, Karl F., and Franz Delitzsch. Commentary on the Pentateuch, 3, reprint, Grand Rapids, MI, Eerdmans Publishing Co., 1949, page 393, on DT 18:9-10 is, Moses groups together all the words which the language contained for different modes of exploring the future and discovering the will of God, for the purpose of forbidding every description of soothsaying, and places the prohibition of Moloch worship at the head, to show the inward connection between soothsaying and idolatry, possibly because fabrication, or passing children through the fire in the worship of Moloch, was more intimately connected with soothsaying and magic than any other description of idolatry. The worship of Moloch was the worship of Saturn. There are perhaps various routes one can take to learn this. One route is a very close examination of the scripture, especially the Old Septuagint. Scriptures actually write of this fact in Amos 5:25-26 and Acts 7:41-43. Amos wrote, "Did ye bring unto me sacrifices and offerings in the wilderness 40 years, O house of Israel? Ye have borne the tabernacle of your king, Sikith Malki CM, or in the Septuagint it reads Skanantiou Moloch, and the shrine, Kiun, of your images, the star of your God, which ye made to yourselves." Amos 5:25-26. The Christian Stephen quotes these passages of Amos and connects it with the worship of the golden calf, bull or Taurus. His words on this are recorded in Acts 7:41. He further connects it in the next verse with the worship of the host of heaven. In line with translations like the Septuagint, he states in verse 43 that Amos 5 refers to the cult of Moloch and the star of the god Rephan. Hebrew writing consists of only the consonants. The vowels can be added with what are termed vocalizations, which are dots. The Jewish scribes, in their contempt for heathen gods, placed vocalizations, vowel indicators, on the word Molech, M-L-C-H, from a Hebrew word for shame. Because the incorrect vocalization was added out of contempt for the heathen names of abominable gods, the word Molech, Saturn worship, has been mistranslated by some translators. Further, the word Kiun, Kaimanu in Assyria, has been represented by the word Rephan in Acts 7:43. Rephan is Kivan, Kiun, which is the Arabian and Syrian way of saying Saturn. Rephan apparently was a very limited or localized way of saying Saturn. The adoration of the calf, bull, in the wilderness was an important act of defiance by the Israelites while Moses went up on the mountain to speak to God face to face. This worship of the bull was actually worship of Saturn. Some call this star worship, and the bull was worshipped because at that time the constellation Taurus, the bull, marked the position of the sun at the time of the spring equinox. The fact that the calf was gold was no accident. Gold has many satanic connotations. For a modern occult reference connecting the bull, astrology, and gold together, see Esoteric Astrology by Alice Bailey, Lucy's Trust, 1951, pages 378-79. Various scholars on ancient religion have written that the worship of Moloch was Saturn worship. For instance, Siculus Diodorus wrote, "There was a brazen statue of Saturn putting forth the palms of his hands, bending in such a manner toward the earth, as that the boy who was laid upon them, in order to be sacrificed, should slip off, and so fall down headlong into a deep burning furnace." The ancient Roman circus, like so many public activities in America, was based upon the occult. The circus had 7 circuits, and had a pyramid in the center with 3 altars, one to Saturn, one to Jove, and one to Mars. This is an example of what the common people knew about Saturn. Moloch, then, was the sun god, during the zodiac period from Taurus to Serpents and Scorpio, which is when the sun is hottest. The Babylonians referred to Saturn as the star of the sun. In the Mithraic Mysteries, Saturn was the sun god. See Hall, Manly P. The Lost Teachings of All Ages. Page 22, in fact, Saturn was the sun god of many of the pagan religions, and was the foundation of the solar temple. Ibid Hall tells us on page 97, lower left, that Saturn is the foundation of the solar temple. The 10 tribes of the Israelites fell into the ritual sacrifices of Moloch, Saturn worship and sacrifice, which brought them their judgment of Assyrian captivity. 2 Kings 17:16-17, astrology, witchcraft, and ritual sacrifice were also associated with Saturn worship. Isaiah the prophet tells those who worship Saturn, "Let now the astrologers, the stargazers, the monthly prognosticators, stand up, and save thee." Isaiah 47:13. Saturn did not save the Israelites from captivity. Ex-Illuminati members have revealed that Saturn is Satan. Yes, Saturn is Satan. The satanic Illuminati here RC teach the high-level students that those who serve Saturn promote the return of the lost sun Saturn. The religion of Saturn is Saturnian Gnosis, which turns out to simply be a rehash of the Gnosticism that the high-level Satanists believe in. Saturn is severe. Jupiter is mild. The merging of Saturn, severity, with Jupiter, mildness, is the creation of the new golden age according to high-level satanic hierarchy teachings. The Earth has been caught in a battle between a bipolar world, the inner solar logos, and the outer Saturnian sphere. The trans-Saturnian planets actually belong to Alcyone, which eventually gets its planets returned. This may be the reason that the satanic hierarchy has treated us to good aliens from the Pleiades. Alcyone is a star in the Pleiades. Saturnian Gnostic teachings are that darkness contains the light. What this means is that darkness is necessary for light to exist. And light appears within the matrix of darkness only by the demiurge Saturn's the Logos. This is what they teach. According to Albert Pike in the Masonic textbook Morals and Dogma given to 320 Masons, the work of the sun is the perfecting, also known as the deification of, man. Christians view that it is Satan's work to teach men that they can be deified, which is rebellion to the one and only true God. Secret high-level teachings. In secret satanic rituals, the Grande Master has a scepter which represents his authority to wield power through the Lord of this world who is known as Saturn. New Age leaders are calling Saturn Sanat Kumara. A devil by any name is still a devil. In a dialogue with a Mother of Darkness, this Mother of Darkness altar provides some interesting information. The dialogue went like this. Mother of Darkness, Saturn is the gateway that must be opened. For a season God has winked that man might be illuminated. But excessive light destroys. Man must not forget his destiny is concerned with loving regeneration of the Earth Mother Gaia worship and balance. Soon the other eye of God must open. Those who are illuminated have kept the balance point. The majority of mankind has not. Few seek the ancient seed of wisdom that springs from the brow of Lucifer. Man becomes forgetful of his spiritual ancestry and destiny. They are Elilin. Keepers of nothing. They fill the earth with their passing and crowd the plains with nothingness. They are a waste of the energies. And so the other eye must open. Each man shall receive abundance in what he seeks. Some call it karma. Interviewer, what do you mean by the other eye? Mother of Darkness, the other eye of God as some would say. Chemosh. Cleansing fire. The outstretched arms of Molech. Interviewer, what has that got to do with Saturn? Mother of Darkness, everything. This is a most secret thing. Saturn is the gateway. The point at which all thought is fixed. The point at which all feeling shall be projected as the eye opens. Much ritual and preparation has gone into the issuance through the gateway of the Ancient Ones. There has been a gathering of the elemental essence to clothe them. A strengthened invisible quintessence to hold them in this plane at the time of Advent. Interviewer, and what will be the result of this Advent? What will it mean? Mother of Darkness, a restoring of balance. Those who do not seek wisdom shall cease. Those who are so bound to the earth that they forget the light shall cease. When the other eye opens, the dawn shall come. The golden dawn shall be upon us and the Sun of Righteousness shall rise with healing in his wings. The urge to sacrifice others is a gift. It is a liberation from the awful rigidity, for at least it permits an awareness of other humans. However badly treated as a result of that awareness, they have served an important purpose. The balance is kept and the light dwells upon the illuminated. The energy is released into the circle and is converted into something powerful and useful. In this way you can see they do not truly die. Light increases. Wisdom grows. Death begets life. The sacred cycle of the ancients. The earth shall regenerate herself when the eye of Molech opens. There the reader has it, secret teachings from a Mother of Darkness on Saturn. Gnosticism believes that there is a force, not Almighty God, - the force as it is called can be used for evil or good. Within the hierarchy of the Satanists, Mariah, their thinking has no problem understanding that Lucifer is the same person as Satan. Satan is what happens when the evil side of the force is being used, and Lucifer is that person when the good side of the force is being used. As in all of the mystery religions and in the occult world in general, people are told different things at different levels. Most people don't want to serve evil. They want to think they are good. Their pride motivates them to want to be thought of as good and great. They will easily follow Lucifer, but are not going to admit to themselves or anyone that they are following Satan. No problem, they are allowed to think they are Luciferians. Or if being a follower of Lucifer is too strong a statement, they can be a worshipper of almost thing. Satan in his pride has provided esoteric teachings on the worship of just about everything. There are esoteric teachings about worshipping rock, mountains, trees, the stars, animal spirits, Mother Earth, etc. If one probes deep enough into the layers of hidden meanings, all of these worships go back to Satan. The five primary interlocked concepts of Satan are all represented by the serpent, which are Lucifer, aka Lightbearer or Godhood, search for light or wisdom, sun worship, the sun god, or energy, fire also called Kundalini force, and the regenerative principle, which is phallic and sex worship. These five interconnected concepts are represented worldwide by snakes, serpents, and represent worship of the supreme serpent Satan. The externalization of the hierarchy. The big event or operation that is being carried out is the externalization of the hierarchy. Satan's secret hierarchy with its pure Satanists have been around for thousands of years. But the satanic conspiracy to control mankind is to become an open conspiracy. The hierarchy is to be externalized. And the elimination of Christians, those who haven't sought worldly wisdom, that worldly wisdom which comes from Satan, is to pave the way for Satan's appearance. The satanic occult conspiracy is to leave its secret confines in Masonic temples and Oddfellow halls and is to permeate society in general. This is what has been happening. The real light must go out for the dark side to feel comfortable coming completely out. The mysteries, also known as the mystery religions, are the mysteries that one is initiated into when one joins Freemasonry. In fact, the very first item any prospective Masonic candidate must do is fill out a form requesting to be initiated into the mysteries. The mystery religions were actually veiled forms of the worship of Lucifer or Satan. Lucifer is simply Satan dressed up as the light bearer. In the mystery religions, the disciples are taught that the spirits of men are the powdered bones of Saturn. When one learns who Saturn is, it is a rather distasteful idea to think that men are taught that their bodies belong to Saturn. Further, Freemasonry teaches about Hiram Abiff and Chiram. It turns out when we study the Hiramic legend by Freemasonry's best philosopher that we learn who Santa Claus is. Santa is a scrambling of Satan. Anyway, the Hiramic legend goes like this. According to Freemasonry, great expert on the mystery religions, Saturn, the old man who lives at the North Pole, and brings with him to the children of men a sprig of evergreen, the Christmas tree, is familiar to the little folks under the name of Santa Claus, for he brings each winter the gift of a new year. Part of the symbols are displayed to the initiated, but he is intentionally led astray by false interpretations. Masonry conceals its secrets from all except the adepts, the sages, and the elect, and uses false explanations for its symbols to mislead those deserving to be misled. This is according to the great Freemason Albert Pike in his book Morals and Dogma. It should come as no surprise that Saturn is one of the items which is mentioned by various Masonic authors. For instance, the Freemason Ragan, who is considered an expert on Freemasonry, wrote, "This is the important phenomenon, the ineffable mystery, the key to nature, which the ancient sages succeeded in discovering, and which they adopted as the basis of Masonic doctrine. It is interpretation, the revolting atrocities of subject of Masonic legends." According to Saturn, were considered interesting enigmas, which involve facts worth our notice. Ragan, T. Eiler General de la Franc McConnery, page 219, as quoted in Moore, Gordon. The Hidden Power Behind Freemasonry, Burnsville, Minnesota, Weissmann PUB, 1990, page 109. Alice Bailey's Esoteric Astrology states that Saturn is the Lord of Karma, page 105, Venus and Saturn shall rule men during Aquarius, page 148. Saturn is the planet of discipleship. We stand at the gateway of the new world, of the New Age and its New Civilization, Ideals, and Culture, page 148. The Occult Book A Treatise on Cosmic Fire, pages 1196-1207 states that Saturn is the fifth creative hierarchy. This is the type of stuff that the Kabbalah comes out with. And American businesses which are controlled by the Illuminati are getting into the act of bringing the occult out into society. Ford called its car Taurus, bull the Pleiades, another car is named Aries, which is another occult astrological name. Then there is the car named Saturn. In conclusion, Saturn turns out to be an occult name for Satan. Santa turns out to be an occult name for Saturn. It also turns out that the name Saturn has been used for Satan for centuries by the occult. The ritual sacrifices to Molech was Saturn worship. The opening of the Eye of Saturn is the materialization of hordes of demons taking place during this time period. High-level Illuminati, who will gather together in Atlanta in the summer of 1996, under the cover of the 96 Olympics, will carry out high-level rituals to open up a large hole for the materialization of hordes of demons to complete their push toward a world dictator. The use of the name Saturn is an example of how Satanism operates under the cover of layers of deception. Many Christian words also have occult meaning. There is a Morning Star Church in Tulsa which ministers to victims of Illuminati trauma-based total mind control. There is also a prophetic magazine named The Morning Star, which is very slick and glossy. On the other side of things, the term the Morning Star-Stella Matutina in Latin is another name for Lucifer. Stella Matutina is also the name of a Kabbalistic black magic lodge which Satanist Aleister Crowley led when the Golden Dawn reorganized in 1903. There are Morning Star rituals done by Illuminati members. One Illuminati slave, who was trained to infiltrate Christian churches and turn them toward the New Age movement, channeled a demon named Jesus. He infiltrated Christian churches for decades, and when he spoke about Jesus, he was referring to the demon he channeled. We know about this because one day, his front altars gave their life to Jesus Christ, and he abandoned his job of infiltration, and sought spiritual help. People need to understand that almost all Christian terms have dual meanings. Just because a term sounds familiar doesn't mean it is being used in the way that a sincere Christian would understand them. In summary, to summarize, the Illuminati are manipulating technology, language, ritualistic activity, subliminal awareness, fear, lust, human vulnerabilities, and conflicts. These manipulations are external deceptions, which help cover up their trauma-based mind control. They use the best covers as fronts. They use fiction, the best of religious fronts, traveling entertainment fronts, and the cover of national defense. They use deflection, blinds, slides, Hegelian dialectics, deniability, and esoteric language. They use agent provocateurs, clean agents, legends, and safe houses. The Illuminati have refined the art of deception far beyond what the common man has imagined. The very life and liberty of humanity requires the unmasking of their deceptions. That is what this book is about.